Welcome to Decisions Today. It's an honor to be here to talk to you guys. I'm going to be sharing some advice on how to harness the power of analytics from an optimization experimentation mindset. I just covered a lot of my background already, so I won't get into it a lot. As I mentioned, I was in the Navy. I did submarine design. I moved out here a while ago to get my MBA, and that's where I discovered that there was this career called product management. And I said, that's exactly what I want to do. And I asked everybody, where's the best place to learn product management since I had never done it? And they said Intuit. So I worked at Intuit. I worked at some startups, Friendster. I consult to companies these days. I took a little break to be a founder of a startup myself. And I'm back to consulting again. And I also run a big group down in Intuit that Split's a sponsor of called Lean Product, because I'm very passionate about sharing best practices. So each month I bring in a top speaker. So my Twitter handle's at Dan Olson, and I post all my slides and talks at danolson.com if you want to check them out. Let's just do this real quick. Who's a product manager? Who works in product management here? All right, we got a lot of product management people. That's awesome. So this is a unique chance to cover one of the most advanced secret product management topics that there is out there, the product manager's motto. And you know, we don't really have a product manager school, so you kind of have to learn this from a experienced product person who can trust you with that secret. It's kind of like Spider-Man's motto. Does anyone know Spider-Man's motto? We're in Silicon Valley. We're in the Bay Area. Someone must know. Who knows it? Yell it out. With great power comes great responsibility. That's Spider-Man's motto. That's right. That's right. Now, the product manager's motto is similar, but just a little bit different. It's with great responsibility comes no power. And so those of you that are product managers, you know, it's just funny. We're laughing, but it's a little sad. We're crying on the inside a little bit too, right? And as PMs, you know, obviously the responsibilities can vary from company to company, but we're responsible for a lot of things usually. Right. And in fact, I like to say good product managers fill a void or fill a vacuum. If there's no UX designer, guess who's doing the mockups, right? If there's no QA, guess who's doing the QA. But I think that two of the main things that we're responsible for are basically, one is product market fit. Oops, let's see if this is going here. Here we go. One is product market fit, right? This is especially in the early days of your product. And what product market fit means, I talk a lot about that in my book. I'm very passionate about that topic. It means, you know, delivering a product to the customers that they find valuable and find better than the other products that are out there. So when we're building a new product in the early days or a new feature even, product market fit is the main thing that we're responsible for. And there's really no one else you can point to in the org. Obviously, the devs, we don't code anything. The devs build it. The designers design it. But if it's like, who's responsible for orchestrating everybody's efforts, when they don't report to us, it's us. And then once we've got product market fit, our secondary goal is growth, right? The executive team wants us to help achieve that hockey stick, whether it's users or revenue or both. At a high level, those are the two things that product teams more broadly, not just product managers, but the team as a whole are responsible for. And so that's basically why I wrote my book, The Lean Product Playbook, to give people a playbook. It's deliberately called a playbook, a tactical guide on how to achieve product market fit and how to use analytics to grow your users and revenue. So I'm going to share some advice from that book today in my 30-minute talk. I'm also happy to give a copy away. If you want to try to win a copy, just send a tweet with my at Dan Olson in it. Throw in a hashtag. The conference hashtag is Decisions2018. You can throw on Split Software if you want. So I'll give one out later on. I know they're giving out 10 as well for good questions and answers, so that's another way. But anyway. I'm going to focus today on the process about how to use analytics. Right? In the first part of the book, it's more about the qualitative aspects of how to achieve product market fit, which is frankly much more qualitative and talking to people. But once you've kind of gotten a certain level of product market fit, it becomes more quantitative. And so I like to give people a step-by-step guide. Obviously, the details of the analytics, the specifics are going to vary depending on your business, but this is a meta framework that you can use for any business to systematically use analytics to optimize it. So it all starts out with identifying what your metrics are. Some people may already have this step done. Other people may be starting from scratch. But what are the actual metrics for our business? Step two is let's start tracking them and measuring what I call the baseline values. Where are we at today on each of these key metrics? And then the next step is once we're tracking all of our key metrics, we can look across them all and say, hey, which one do we think offers the most upside, the highest ROI to really make an impact on the metric that we're trying to move, if it's revenue or users? And this is all happening at the global product or business level, right? And at some point, we're going to look at all those metrics and say, this is the one that we think is the top metric that we should focus on, that offers the highest ROI. And at that point, we go into a separate loop that's focused on optimizing that metric. And that loop starts with, great, we said we want to improve this conversion rate. Let's brainstorm as a team. What are all the different ways to improve that conversion rate? And this is great because you suspend disbelief and you brainstorm. The next step then is you converge and you say, great, let's try to estimate the ROI of these different ideas. And then you pick the top idea and you commit to designing and implementing it and you roll it out. And you hope, and you see how the metric changes. And you hope that the metric goes up and to the right as a result of doing this. But even if it doesn't, you're winning and you're gaining value because you're learning and you're iterating. This is very much an iterative process. The first one or even two things you try may not really move the needle. But eventually you'll learn and find something that will move the needle. And then what will happen is, especially if you haven't done this before, it's kind of easy to find some low-hanging fruit. But eventually it'll get harder and harder to move that needle. And you'll get diminishing returns. At that point, it'll make sense to stop focusing on the metric that you've optimized already and go back to the list of all the metrics and say, great, that one's pretty optimized. What's the next one that offers the best ROI for our business right now? So that's the lean product analytics process. I'm going to talk about it as opposed to applied to product market fit and growth and close out with an example for you guys. And the key thing I want to say again is that at any point in time, this is kind of like an engineering optimization mentality, there's one metric that offers the highest ROI, right? And I call that the metric that matters most. Like based on the status quo and the current condition of your product and business, there's one of those metrics that's going to offer the biggest ROI, and we want to focus the right metric at the right time. And that will obviously change over time as the environment changes, as your product changes, and as you optimize these things. But that's the general idea, is to focus on the metrics that metric that matters most. Let's do a quick little mini example of this. Let's say we just launched a new product. We just launched it yesterday. Right? And we have three choices of what we can focus our time and attention and resources on. Either acquisition, which is all about attracting prospects to get them to our marketing or sales channels, right? So we can then, number two, conversion, convert them into from prospects into customers, however we define customers, whether it's paying customers or registered customers. And then the third choice that we have that we can optimize on is retention, which is, okay, once we've captured these customers, what percentage are we keeping active? So let's just show hands. Vote for acquisition, conversion, retention. If you had a new product, who would focus on optimizing acquisition first? Raise your hand. Okay. Who would focus on optimizing conversion first? Oh, raise your hand. And who would optimize on who would focus on optimizing retention first? Okay, so we got a pretty even split. And there's no one right answer, but in general, the way I think about it, I like to think of the leaky bucket metaphor. I don't have time to get into all the slides in this talk, but basically the idea is the water that's in the bucket is your active customers. And acquisition is like spraying a hose at the bucket and trying to get water in the bucket, trying to get customers in the bucket. Conversion is what percentage of the water gets in the bucket. And the retention is what percentage of the water stays in the bucket over time. And unfortunately, everybody, no matter how good your company is, has a leaky bucket. The only question is, how big are those holes? Is it a big gaping hole and all the water's rushing out, or are they little holes, right? So for me, because of that, and because acquisition usually costs money, most people say it makes sense to, and I specifically said we just launched the product, right? We want to make sure that our bucket isn't super leaky, because if we spend a lot of time trying to get a bunch more water in there, we may feel good that we got a lot of water in the bucket, but it's all just going to leak out anyway. So most people start with retention, make sure their bucket isn't too leaky. Then they move on to conversion, which is, hey, let's improve the aim that we're shooting the water in the bucket. And once those two are optimized enough, like it's never going to be 100%, then we can move on to acquisition so that when we do pay or spend or spend time or money to acquire somebody, the conversion rate will be higher, the retention rate will be higher. That's an example of what I mean by the metric that matters most among those three and a logic and a rationale for why you would sequence them that way. As I mentioned, I like to focus a lot on product market fit. When you are tracking metrics, you can have track a lot of metrics. You know, some people may be just starting in their metrics journey. Other people may have like metrics out the wazoo and not really know what to focus on. So you can have too many metrics as well. But again, if you want to focus on measuring product market fit on this particular one, you had to pick one metric, what metric would you pick? I'd love to hear what people think. There's no right answer again. Yell it out. Retention. Okay. Engagement. Revenue, dollar signs, I like it. Lifetime value of the customer, right? Dollar signs over time, nice, yeah? Anybody else?
Rate of customer acquisition.
Rate of customer acquisition, cool.
And combination of all of that.
Combination of all of that. All the things. Track all the things. Okay, cool. That's good. Yeah, so again, there's no one right answer, and one answer I didn't get, which I often get, is Net Promoter Score, NPS. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with that, right? And one of the key things I talk about in the book and my other talks is the difference between behavioral metrics and attitudinal metrics. And someone could say, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, how likely would you be to recommend my product? Oh, definitely a 10, definitely a 10. But then do they ever actually recommend it to somebody or not, right? That's behavioral. So what I like is attitudinal metric. I mean, sorry, behavioral metric. That's attitudinal. I like a behavioral metric where it's actually, there can't be any difference between what people say and what they do. That can happen, so we're just tracking what they actually do. And if you think about it, you know, I could be the world's best marketer and write this amazing landing page with amazing copy, selling you snake oil, this amazing product that's going to solve all your problems, and get you to click and convert and pull out your credit card. And then you get in there and you realize it's a piece of junk and it doesn't actually meet your needs, right? So in contrast, think for a second about how many restaurants have you been to more than 3 times? How many movies have you seen more than 3 times, right? The things that you go back to, you've experienced, and you choose to go back to again and again are the things that really create the most value for you. It's the same thing with a product. If I trick you into using it, you're not going to come back after you kick the tires and realize it didn't meet your needs. But if it truly meets your needs, you're going to come back again and again and again. So for me, retention rate, if I had to pick one, retention rate is what I would track to measure product market fit. Now let me explain retention rate. It's a way of looking at users that tracks what percentage of customers are still active over time. You can think about it as tracking the level in that bucket on a percentage basis, right? So here's an example of a retention rate curve. On the y-axis, we've got percentage of users returning over time. And then over here, we've got days since first use. So this isn't like calendar days like January, February, March. What you do is for each user, you re-index this metric to count from the day they started to from then on out, right? So we're re-indexing every customer to have a relative start date, if you will. And the first thing you'll notice is this graph doesn't even start at 100%. I could start at 100%, but it would just be a bunch of white space and make the graph harder to see. Why is that? Well, sadly, what does that mean? What this is saying is, sadly, for this particular app, and this is real data from a mobile app, 80% of the people never come back after they first launch it. Pretty brutal, especially on mobile, right? And just think about it. If you told me some cool mobile app and I installed it and checked it out for a few minutes and then I closed it and put it in my pocket, what are the odds the next day I'm going to wake up in the morning and go, hey, what was that app, right? That's why they're so persistent about, hey, the second you launch, can I get notifications? Push notifications, please, so they have a chance to get back. Anyway, then it drops off for a while. It drops off usually pretty sharply, and then the slope decreases. And then at the end of this curve, I've shown a nice optimistic scenario here. One of two things can happen. It can it can basically stay flat, eventually hit some flat asymptote, which is usually at some low percentage, or it can actually more commonly, for a new product, it goes to zero. Right? It may be 90 days, maybe 60 days, maybe 30 days, but it goes to zero. What does going to zero mean? Sadly, that means that all those customers that you work so hard to get leak out of the bucket. And I will say almost every product, every V1 product goes to zero pretty much. And right, you see about these overnight success companies, they didn't have that overnight success. They iterated to get to the point where they held on to more of the customers in their bucket. All right, now say you launch your product, and it's been like 6 or 12 months since you launched your product. Well, the thing about this is we're putting all the customers into a single bucket for analysis. And someone might say, well, you know, Dan, our product is a lot better now than it was 12 months ago. Why are we including all those people that left us in this metric and dragging us down? So at some point, you want to divide your user base to be able to slice and dice and compare the retention rate across different cohorts. That's what cohort analysis is, basically, right? The most common way to do it is to take it based on when they signed up so you can see changes over time, but it doesn't have to be that way. It can be from acquisition channel. It can be from customer segmentation, whatever it is. So here's an example. When you do cohort analysis, you'll have more than one curve. And by the way, if you end up doing this and you have like 10 plus curves, it gets crazy. For those of you who've seen it, it's really hard to tell what's going on with 10 curves. So this is a simple example of 3 curves. Again, we've got percentage of users returning on the y-axis. We've got how many weeks since they signed up this time instead of days. And we've got 3 groups of users. Cohort A is the blue diamonds. Cohort B is the red squares. And cohort C is the green triangles. Now, I want you to start. This is another audience participation, so I need everybody to participate. I want you to think about, imagine you're the product manager for this product. Which of these 3 cohorts would you rather be the cohort that you have for your customers? Who would prefer to have cohort A as their customers? Who would prefer to have cohort B for their customers? Who would prefer to have cohort C for... Did you guys just have a meeting at the break and say, when Dan puts the slide up, we're all going to say C, right? Why is it... You guys have a PhD in retention rate that I don't know about, right? Why is it? Your brain knows. When you look at the data the right way, and that's the power of good analytics, when you look at the data the right way, the intuition and the answer is kind of obvious, right? Why is this, why, for those of you that picked the A or C, basically, why is that the valuable one? Someone want to say why? Value over time. What's that?
The least drop.
That's interesting, yeah.
Biggest area under the curve.
All right, we're doing integrals. I like it. at the end, the most users are active. That's basically it. There's a lot of stuff going on, but it's this, right? Like, this is just noise. It turns out that, hey, even though cohort A started out super strong, for a few weeks later, they weren't as strong. So yes, you summarized it well. What matters the most is, where does this thing end up? And the higher, the better, right? Now, in my book, I talk a lot about also Oprah versus Spock, where Oprah is the master of qualitative interviewing techniques, and Spock is the master of statistics and analytics. And a lot of times in the early days, you know, I recommend talking to groups of 5 to 10, and people are like, that's not statistically significant. 10 is not statistically significant, right? And so, you know, you're just trying to make this kind of progress iteratively from wave to wave, and I get people, some Spock, saying, well, how do you know it's statistically significant? So this basically is a way to have statistical significance of your measure of product market fit. So what I'm trying to tell you is, wherever this value ends up at the end, that is a quantitative, attitudinal, at-scale measure of product market fit. So if you really want to know if you have product market fit or not, and what level you have to be tracking your retention rate and seeing where it ends up, right? And the idea here is, over time, as you improve your product, say we launched our product, you know, it's funny, we were just discussing an article about Reid Hoffman's quote, if you didn't launch your product, you know, if you weren't embarrassed by it, you launched it too late, right? So and he qualified that. But the bottom line is, let's say we launched our embarrassed MVP 24 months ago, and this was a retention rate curve that we have. And we just, you know, we were only holding on to, say, 5% of people after 12 months, right? In the next 6 months, we worked really hard, we listened to customers, we fixed bugs, we fixed the UX design, we added features, we understood our customer better, and we did a new cohort for 6 months later, we would want to see something like this, where the whole curve shifts up, and most importantly, that terminal value of retention rate goes up. That would tell us that, hey, in those intervening 6 months, we improved product market fit by that much. And in the next 6 months, we do the same thing and do our best to improve our product, and we should see something like that, right? So that's what you want to see. One, you want to have it be non-zero to start out with. If it's not, get it to non-zero. And then over time, you want to work hard on the things we talked about to improve product market fit to move that curve up. And I like to back up these concepts that I share with real-world data when I can. So I was excited to see this data from the Android App Store, where they did a retention rate cohort analysis. Now, the way they did these cohorts is a particular way. They took, again, just to be clear, we have the percentage of users that are still remaining active over here, going up to 100%, and we have the days since they installed the Android app. And what they did is they did the cohorts a specific way. They took the top 10 apps and said, let's make that a cohort. That's this top red line. Let's take the next 50 apps, we're not going to include those apps again, and have it be that line and that line and that line. You can see that it proves out exactly what I'm saying. The top most successful apps are the ones that have the highest terminal value or retention rate. They have the strongest product market fit. And, you know, we went down to 5,000. You can see it quickly drops off to about 10. You know, if we took the bottom 10,000 apps, it would probably go to zero, right? But that's the idea, basically, is that it's a measure of product market fit. Now, at some point, once we've got product market fit, and by the way, retention rate, that matters for every business. And sometimes in B2B, we get into discussions about, well, what about, they already signed a 3-year contract, Dan, they're locked in. Well, there's usage retention and there's purchase retention. And I guarantee if you don't have usage retention, you're probably going to have a problem with purchase retention pretty soon. So don't get tripped up by that. But the bottom line is, retention applies for every product. And when it comes to growth, now you have to take the specifics of your particular business into account, right? And that's the tool that I recommend in my book for that is what I call the equation of your business, where we get really specific about your business, and we do what I call peeling the onion. You know, again, back to my engineering roots, if I want to optimize something, I want to be able to express it as an equation. And you may be wondering, well, how can I write an equation for my business? Well, every business follows profit equals revenue minus loss. Minus cost. And for most tech businesses, the marginal cost isn't a big deal, and the marginal revenue is what matters the most over time as you hit scale. So you can basically just start breaking down the revenue into meaningful items. This is not actionable, right? If your CEO came to you and said, grow revenue, you would know exactly what to do. The idea here is to break it down and peel the onion into actionable metrics that we can then have a discussion and debate about which one do we think is the one that matters the most right now and is going to have the highest ROI. That's the idea. Right? And what I'm going to do is break it down for a particular business model, advertising business model. I know some of you in the room may not be in advertising, but it's a really good example of how you can break things down into granular metrics where you can make clear decisions. So let's break down revenue. By the way, this is for a given time period, a month, a quarter, a year, a day is what we're talking about, right? So we can break down revenue and say, okay, for this last month, let's take September, we can express revenue as the product of how many visitors came to our site, times what was the average revenue we made per visitor, right? So if we had 1 million visitors and we made $10 million in ad revenue last month, that would be, you know, basically $10 per visitor times 1 million, $10 million in revenue. That would be the idea, right? We can break down ad revenue per visitor. That's still not actionable. The way we make money in an advertising site, think of BuzzFeed or something like that, right? The way you make money is how many impressions. It's through ad impressions. So we can say, on average, how many impressions did the average visitor generate? And then the monetization of those is through CPM, which has a factor of 1,000 in it, so we just divide by 1,000, right? Then we can now break down impressions per visitor, right? In a given month, the average impressions per visitor is the product of, well, how many times did they come in the month? Did they come 3 times to BuzzFeed that month on average, or did they come once? When they came, each session or visit, how many page views did they generate? Did they generate 5 page views or 10 on average? And then for each of the page views, how many ad impressions did they generate? So that's a way to really peel the onion and get down. This is why I love this example, because now, again, this revenue is not really, it's hard to talk about. Even our ad revenue per visitor is hard to think about how we're going to move it. But now we have very specific things that we can have a discussion on our product team. If we wanted to improve visits per visitor, what could we do? Well, we might be able to send out emails to people and say, hey, we saw you read this article on BuzzFeed. Check out these other 5 articles and get them to come back more than they would have come back, right? Page views per visit. How could we think? Imagine you're the product manager for BuzzFeed. You want to improve page views per visit. How would you do that? You ever go to those annoying sites that have, they break the article up into 10 pages and they make you go next, 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 next? That's because the PM there said, hey, I'm going to try to improve page views per visit so I get more ad revenue here, right? And then finally, impressions per page view. How could we improve that, increase that? Well, just slap more ads on the page. If there's 2 per page, let's put 3, 4, 5, right? And obviously, you get into some whack-a-mole situations. If you push these up too much, then people will come back less frequently and things like that. But the point is, for this business model, we can now have discussions with our team. And because you could write this all out as one long equation, if you improve this by 10%, it directly turns into 10% more revenue. If you improve this by 15%, it directly turns it into 15%. So instead of having these gut intuition level things, that's still some estimation on how much it's going to move the needle, but at least you have some solid causality underneath it. Going back to visitors, if you were trying to grow visitors, it's always beneficial, whether it's visitors or customers, to distinguish between new and returning. New means who came to us as a new customer or visitor for the first time in that time period that we're talking about. Returning means who came during that time period, but they had already been a customer or a visitor before. And that's really important to track, because then what you can do is break down your returning visitors, and it's just, well, how many visitors did we have last time times some monthly retention rate? Again, retention comes back in, right? And that may end up being a very powerful metric that moves out. In fact, in SaaS businesses, with that churn rate, it's got a 1- factor in it, basically. It's like, one, this is the same, I could have written this as 1- churn, because that 1- factor, small changes in your churn rate can have a big difference, big impact on SaaS. So the idea is, I've showed this for advertising, don't focus on advertising. Think about for your business model, if it's subscription or e-commerce or whatever it is, what would be the detailed metrics that you could have discussions with your team about? All right, this is, I don't expect anybody to know what this thing is called. It's kind of a weird object. But it's basically, I mentioned I used to work on submarines, and submarines, they have a propulsion plant, and ships have a propulsion plant, and you have to keep track of all this, like, pressures and levels and things like that. This is called a gauge board. It's just a board that has a bunch of gauges on it. And this is like a single dashboard, a physical real-world dashboard, as opposed to a metrics dashboard, where you see the key metrics for the ship, basically, the ship's propulsion plant, to make sure it's operating optimally. And that's how I think about your key metrics for a software, for any of the tech businesses that you guys run and work on. That's how I view. Think about this dashboard of dials and gauges. And I like to view each of those metrics back from the equation of your business, right? Visits per visitor, impressions per visitor, things like that, as a gauge. And I mean this very literally, a gauge. A gauge has a minimum value. This is important to think about. What's the minimum value? So for example, for a percentage metric, 0 to 100 has a minimum value of 0, a maximum value of 100. And I couldn't find one that had a dial pointing at a non-zero value, so let's just imagine there's a current value. Those are the three things to think about as you're looking across the metrics, once you're tracking baselines, to say, where are we at today? What's the min? What's the max? To assess the upside, basically, right? And again, we want to look across our gauges and figure out which metrics do we as a team think matters the most. What's the upside potential of each of those gauges? How much do we think we can move that needle on the gauge? What would the corresponding revenue impact be from the equation of the business, which we can express quantitatively? And then on the cost side, how many resources is it going to take? You know, to build that feature that we think is going to move the needle 10%, how much is it going to take as far as money and dev time, right? And we want to figure out which metrics offers the highest ROI. And so to be more explicit about that, we want to run our ideas, those different ideas that we come up with once we focus on a metric, we want to run them through some high-level ROI, return on investment, analysis. And I'm showing this with numbers. I'm not trying to imply it's overly precise. In the book, I also have just high, medium, low quadrants, and you can just put the sticky notes in the quadrants as well, right? So don't get tripped up on the exact numbers. Usually, it's pretty easy to estimate developer weeks quantitatively. With the equation of your business, it's pretty easy to estimate revenue impact if you wanted, or user impact. When it gets to product market fit and customer value, you can get a little fuzzier. But let's say we have two ideas, idea A and B. The team agrees based on our best estimates that they're both going to deliver 3 units of value, the same rough amount of value. And idea A is going to take 1 week, and idea B is going to take 2 weeks. Well, idea A has twice the ROI of idea B because it's half the cost, and we would focus on that one first. A lot of times you end up with ideas that offer similar ROIs. So here idea C is 2 for 2, and idea D is 4 for 4. When you have these situations, I usually recommend pursuing the smaller scope idea first for a few reasons. One, it'll get built and actually launched into the market sooner, so you'll realize the value sooner. You'll get the learnings from the market sooner. And then the other big reason is scope estimation error. You know, these aren't perfect estimates. Scope estimation error is nonlinear, right? If I tell you, yeah, I'll get that to you in an hour, I'm probably not going to slip a month. But if I tell you, yeah, I'll have that enterprise software product for you in 18 months, it could easily slip to 20, 24, you know, 28 months, right? There are obviously bad ideas out there, right? Low return, a lot of investment. Usually the team thinks that that's going to be up here where D was. So they're working and working and working and feeling the investment as they work, but then they launch it, and then they realize it didn't have the impact that they wanted. And our job as product teams are to find the high ROI ideas that are really going to create customer value and move the needle. And then I think good product managers are able to work with their engineering team. There's almost always 80-20 at play, where you don't need to build everything that you first thought of for that feature to get 100% of the value. You can shave off the less value contributing parts. Now, once you've done this analysis, then you can just prioritize and sort your ideas in order of the ROI, and we would do idea for A first, B first, C second, and we would have a diminishing returns curve, right? We would pursue those ideas and hopefully move the needle in the way that we think, and eventually, like I said, it would flatten out and we'd have to go back and work on a different metric. Now, when you do this kind of ROI analysis, I've found that there are really three main situations, ROI situations you come across. The first is what I call a good ROI situation. And what I'm showing here is a little chart that shows the return, the investment, and this line represents if we pursue the highest ROI opportunity available to us, what can we expect? And the yellow dot is where we are today. So this is a good ROI curve because with a little bit of investment, we can move up quite a bit and deliver a fair amount of return. The next category of ROI situation is a bad ROI. So again, we've got the same ROI curve if we pursue the best opportunities, return and investment. But now we're up here. The yellow dot where we are is up here. So even if we put in a lot of investment, we're not going to get much return. So those are the main categories that you see. There is a third category that's not as common, but you do see it, especially when you first start doing analytics optimization. And I call that the great ROI curve, or what I call the silver bullet metric. And here, it's fundamentally got a different ROI curve. And by analyzing the situation, you can realize that by, hey, with a highly leveraged metric, that just by fixing this one metric, it can have a very big impact on what you're trying to drive, as indicated here. All right, so those are the three categories that you see. To close out, I just want to close out with an example where I applied this process. It was a while back at Friendster. When I went into Friendster, it was a post-Series A startup with about 50 people. Everybody in the building, I said, hey, what's important to you guys? What do you think we should focus on? As a new head of product, everyone said, we need to focus on viral growth. We need to basically get new users from our existing users without paying for them. We need to optimize viral growth. I said, great, sounds great, I agree. What have we done so far? The answer was nothing. We haven't done anything yet. Okay, cool. Step one, we got clear on our objective. Step one, let's go track our metrics. So I had to figure out what metrics to track. And so what I did is I had to decide what am I going to instrument the viral loop. And so here's what I did basically. I created a simple model of, hey, active users are the ones that invite their friends. A certain percentage of the active users invite their friends. Those prospective users get an email, an invitation email. They either click on it or they don't. If they click on the invitation email, they end up in our registration process where they either get through it or they don't. The ones that get through it become users. a certain portion of which remain active, right? So this is the basic user experience diagram. I said, okay, now I want to apply some metrics on here, and how am I going to track this? So the metrics that I added, and by the way, I'm a big fan of ratio metrics. Instead of absolute number metrics, like ratio metrics that are much more easy to compare apples to oranges over time and scale differences. So here was a percentage of users who are active. The next one was what percentage of our users are sending invites. There's actually a secondary one here because when someone decides to invite their friends, they can invite one friend, they can invite three or five at a time. So the secondary metric of how many, on average, invites per sender are they sending out. For the email, there's an invitation click-through rate on the email, and there's a registration conversion rate, basically. So those are the five metrics that I used, that I put in place and said we need to start tracking these so that we can optimize the viral growth. So multiplied together, they determine your viral ratio. I want you, for this case study, to pretend you were the brand new head of product at Friendster, and you've gotten this far, and now how to figure out which of these five am I going to focus on, right? We have limited engineering resources. Let's make it simpler. Let's narrow it down to three. Percentage of users sending invites, invites per sender, and conversion rate. So again, I need audience participation. Pretend, I know you don't have a lot of information, pretend you're the head of product at Friendster. Who would thinks they should focus on optimizing percentage of users sending invites? Raise your hand. Who thinks we should focus on invites per sender? Raise your hand. Who thinks we should focus on improving the conversion rate? Raise your hand. Okay. So a lot for C, some for B, not many for A. Remember I said the next step in the process is what are the baseline values, right? And I asked you on purpose before I showed you the baseline values just to show you the power of knowing nothing else. You guys aren't social networking experts and viral loop optimization experts. Some of you may be. But this is the power of just knowing the baseline values. Let's do this again and revote. So percentage of users sending invites was sitting at 15% of users. The average number of invites sent per sender was sitting at 2.3. And the registration conversion rate was sitting at 85%. Why don't we revote now that we have baseline values? Who now would focus on improving the percentage of users sending invites? Yeah, see, that's the power of just knowing it's 15%. Before you didn't know, right? Who would focus on improving invites per sender now? And who would focus on conversion rate? Right. So these went way up and these went way down just by knowing one number. So I don't like to trick people, but I do that to impress upon you the value of knowing where are you today, even if you know nothing else about the domain. Now, what's going on? Just kind of like the retention rate curve. Your brain, you know, has this hack and it kind of knows to change its mind when you get new data. Why is that? Well, there's a hack called the upside potential of a metric that I want to walk you through. Again, not knowing anything else. Remember those gauges that I said? A gauge has a minimum value and a maximum value, right? So registration conversion rate or process yield, it's a percentage metric. So the min is 0, the max is 100. Where are we today? Where's that dial pointing today? 85%. Now, I don't know how much we can really move it, but I can tell you in the best world, what's the max possible improvement we could do is 15 percentage points from where we are. And if we express that as a percentage of where we are, no matter what we do, we cannot move it more than 18%. That's the most we can do, basically, right? The second metric, percentage of users sending invite, it's also a percentage metric. So it goes from 0 to 100. We're sitting at 15. I'm not saying we could achieve all that headroom, but we've got 85 percentage points that we can go higher. Expressed as where we are today, that's 570%. Between those two, it's pretty obvious which one is more likely to be fruitful, right? The last one, I need some audience participation here. Average number of invites sent per sender. What's the min value for that one? What's the max value for that one? A million billion. I usually get infinity. Thanks for containing yourself. I usually get infinity. People get really excited. A million billion, any other? 7 billion. 7 billion, yeah. Population, it usually goes infinity, population of the world. Wait, how many people are on the internet exactly? And then you get that. So you get excited, but it's fundamentally a different metric. Just by thinking about min, max, it's just fundamentally a different metric, right, than the other percentage metrics were. We're sitting at 2.3. So we're x divided by 2.3 equals y, you know? And you can do the math to figure out what would it have to be bigger than 570. It doesn't have to be that big. And then you eventually get down to like sociology theory and say, well, how many friends does the average person really have and things like that? It ends up between like 150 and 250. Even at 150, it blows this one out of the water, right? Is anyone feeling a sense of deja vu from something I said a little bit earlier? See a black cat going across the back of the stage? Remember I said that there's three different profiles you tend to see in ROI curves? There's the bad ROI curve. Well, this one where we're sitting at 85% already, right? That's a bad ROI curve already all the way up there. I said there's a good ROI curve. That's the percentage of users seeing invites. We're sitting at 15%, and you know, in general, we think there's good opportunities. That third one, I don't know yet, but it sounds like it could be a silver bullet metric because it's fundamentally different. We're sitting at 2.3. It could be 100 billion for all we know, you know, and millions and billions. So that seems like it could be. So for those reasons, we focused on this one, right? And a couple other reasons why is one, trust me, we had tried to get people to invite their friends already, right? And they just didn't. We had invite buttons all over. For whatever reason, only 15% of people were doing it. And this would require changing behavior. This would require just getting people who are already inviting their friends to do more. It's always easier to get people to do more of what they're already doing than to get them to do new things. So we said, great, next step, we're going to focus on that metric. How do we increase the number of invites being sent per sender? And we brainstorm a bunch of ideas for each idea. What's the benefit? How much is it going to move, you know, that viral, that metric? And then we know from the equation of the business that what the impact would be. What's the expected cost? How many engineer days will it take? And what I didn't tell you also is back then, you had to actually type in each of your friends' email addresses. So no wonder it was only 2.3. So our top idea was to build an email address book importer where it would just suck in all your friends. You could check off the ones you wanted. So a lot less user effort. And again, we had to build it for each email provider. So we did an analysis and figured out what the biggest email provider was. And we built it for them. And the engineer said, hey, it's going to take about a week and a half for one person. So we said, great, let's go for it. What was the before and after impact? So here we are tracking along at our baseline of 2.3. So again, this is when a Friendster user invites their friends, on average, how many do they invite? And on average, it's pretty stable at 2.3 here. We rolled out the feature. This is a 7-day average, by the way, so it took a little while to go. And it shot up to more than double to over 5, basically, right? So from 1 week's worth of effort. So it did turn out to be a silver bullet metric. Just with 1 week's of effort, we more than doubled this, which because of the equation of the viral loop, more than doubled the number of new viral users that we were getting. So I was pretty excited about that. So that's an application of the process. Again, to sum up the process, you want to identify what your metrics are, the baseline values. You saw the power of the baseline values. Make sure you're tracking those. And by the way, there's usually a data hygiene phase where what you think you're tracking isn't what you're tracking, and there's data accuracy and your tags and all that stuff, right? So I see people nodding knowingly with the data hygiene pains. And then eventually, once you have it all cleaned up, then you can look across, use that upside potential hack that we just saw, pick a metric, and go into that loop where you brainstorm, identify ROI, design, and analyze it, and then iterate, and then eventually go back and optimize another one. In this example, I just want to share some other stuff about, we're talking about optimization and experimentation. There are ways to up your game. This was a long time ago, you can see it was a before and after test. And before and after is fine, but it's better if you can do them simultaneously to avoid any other exogenous factors influencing your test. So that's one way to improve your game from what I had done. The other thing is, instead of rolling it out to everybody, rolling things out partially to a percentage of your user base. And that's where the idea of feature flags come in. And if you haven't talked to Split about that, I'd recommend talking about that to them. The other thing is I tested one alternative. And it'd be great if you could actually test multiple alternatives and see, okay, let's have 10% of traffic on this version of that, 10% here, 10% there. Obviously, you got to be mindful of your dev resources doing that, but that can be a way to really see, to explore and experiment. And it actually takes a lot of work to make sure that this user consistently sees this feature or version of it, and this one takes this. And I heard someone earlier, a speaker, talking about statistics and power and things like that, right? There's a lot of stuff behind the scenes. So at the end of the day, you also got to figure out, am I going to buy or build this thing? And if you're a big company like Amazon or something, you've already built it, right? But buying it could be a way to accelerate and get all this stuff kind of built out of the box to check it out. So if you're excited about this is kind of like the new frontier beyond analytics, of like feature flags and experimenting. It's an exciting time in product management to have those tools available. And at the end of the day, what matters the most is getting a high experimentation velocity for your team so that you get a high learning velocity, which will help you improve that metric that much quicker. Last thing I just want to mention, for those of you in the Bay Area, I'm giving a workshop, an all-day workshop up here in the city on the 24th. I have a special discount code if anybody's interested. Split or just come see me later. I'm happy to chat with you about it. And I just want to thank everybody, and I'll do questions later at the panel.